You're listening to the Radius Church Podcast, recorded live each Sunday in North Hollywood, California.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Nick Mosseri. Oh my gosh, you guys, this is so nice of you. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Nick Mosseri. You may know me from such iconic roles as a host who says things that you probably shouldn't at church. Or totally whatever acoustic guitar player. Yeah, you've seen me do that a few times. But Joseph is in Texas this morning preaching at another church, and he asked me to share a talk that I gave to the Radius staff just a couple of weeks ago as part of a communicator development program that he's had some of us going through. And so I'm excited to be here with you this morning to share this. And this is actually the first in our new series that we're calling Move. Joseph hoped to launch the series last week, but we had a scheduling conflict with a wildfire. Really would not work with us. So, you know, you guys get me instead today. So I am excited. All right, so jumping right in, by show of hands, not that I can actually see any of you, but, oh, there you go. We have some lights. I don't actually need to see your hands. I don't care. But by show of hands, how many of you cringe just a little bit these days at the word evangelical, right? It comes with some baggage. You hear it in the media and it sounds like it's a curse word, evangelicals, or it's as though it's an invasive species. There was a herd of evangelicals going through town and they appeared to be quite judgy. And in fairness, we've brought some of that upon ourselves, right? We have maybe focused too much on certain political agendas or attached ourselves too closely to certain celebrities or just generally soiled the bed, as it were. But what if I told you that my goal in the next 90 minutes, because we're not going to be here that long, just seeing who's paying attention, was actually to turn you all into capital E, can I get an amen? Evangelicals. Amen. Yes, no, I bet most of you wish I would not do that to you this morning. But that is my goal. But let's look at it a different way. So how many of you feel completely overwhelmed by the brokenness that you see in this city or in the world or in this country, right? How many of you feel overwhelmed by the political divide that we're dealing with right now? Yeah, right? And it can feel, or what about the homelessness or the hopelessness in this city? It can be just overwhelming. And then also, how many of us just feel totally unequipped to share our faith at a time when there's so much hostility toward the church and so much hypocrisy within the church? It can feel just completely paralyzing. So thanks for letting me share my existential dread. I'm going to pray for us now. That's really all I've got. Actually, one of the most powerful tools for addressing the brokenness of the city and of this world, as well as authentically sharing Jesus' love, is something so simple that most of you have probably already done it and didn't even realize it. And so the secret is actually found in a letter. It was written by a Jesus follower named Paul. Paul wrote a lot of letters. This one was to a group of people in Rome, so he called it Romans. Also, fun fact, Paul loved the people of Rome because he was just crazy about pizza. I can't believe that exists. That makes me so happy. All right. So, but Paul, all right, let's get that out. All right. So Paul really didn't know the people of Rome that well, but he knew that they were being persecuted and that they were in need of some encouragement on kind of the fundamentals of the faith. And if you are exploring faith for the first time, Romans is actually a great kind of Christianity 101 resource. Highly recommend it. If you have a Bible or a Bible app, go ahead and turn to Romans 15. Otherwise, we will have the sentences up on the screen behind me. All right, so we're going to jump in right at verse 1. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. Then jumping to verse 5, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. So here's what Paul is saying. In verse 1, we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak. Help people in need. Verse 2, let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. Help your neighbors. Verse 5, may the God of endurance and encouragement. Also, I just love that God is a God of endurance and encouragement. I don't know how your weeks were. I could use a little more endurance and encouragement. But he says to grant you to live in such harmony with one another. So we live in harmony. And then verse 7, very explanatory. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you. And if we stop there, can we just agree that the world would be such a better place if Christians just help the needy, help their neighbor, lived in harmony, and welcome people as Jesus welcomed us? Even people who aren't interested in Jesus can agree that that would be a good thing to do. But what Paul's really talking about here and what the big topic for our time together today is hospitality. Now, hospitality brings together or brings to mind a number of different things for people. Maybe it's something food-related, or maybe it's about politeness or generosity, or if you're from the South, it's just a way of life filled with sweet tea, chitlins, biscuits, and more sweet tea. Amen. That's right. Amen. Amen. Mm. Or maybe we confuse it with entertaining. I know I did for a long time. My wife, Beth, and I love having people over to the house. We love throwing parties. But in those scenarios, we're playing the role of host, and the people we invite over are our guests. And our purpose is to make sure that our guests have a good time and feel welcomed and loved. And there's nothing wrong with that. Some of you are amazing at entertaining, and you should keep doing that. But hospitality actually goes further. Where entertaining is an event, hospitality is a relationship. And in a relationship, you move toward the needs of another person and allow them to move toward your needs in return. And I love meeting needs. I used to own a pickup truck just for the sole purpose of being the guy that you knew with a pickup truck. I'm not kidding. Yeah, some clap. Some people have used that pickup truck. It's no longer with us. But I look at meeting needs as a sport. Sometimes I can go a little bit overboard, as you'll see in these next couple stories. I grew up outside the Seattle area, and I worked as a barista when I was 16, because I'm a cliche. That's what you do in Seattle. It was either that or being a grunge band, and I didn't own enough flannel. So I used to work in this coffee shop, and we would have homeless folks come in from time to time, and we would buy them a cup of coffee, or I would use my food discount to get them something to eat. And then I would often offer to give them rides across town. And then at the end of the ride, I would like throw them a Bible real quick or like tell them about Jesus. And I couldn't understand why my parents would get upset at me when I would tell them these stories. I thought they'd be so proud. And yet I was doing the two things you are never supposed to do as a kid: talk to strangers and get in vehicles with them. It is literally a miracle I did not end up on a milk carton somewhere. For you movie buffs, this is from Lost Boys. For those of you born after 1990, you will not know that they used to put the pictures of missing children on milk cartons, but they stopped doing that because doctors said it was too scary for children. As a child of the 1980s, I can tell you I was constantly feared of being kidnapped, so I think they were right. Moving on. And then more recently, I was in downtown LA. It was like 10 or 11 at night, and heading back to my car, and I see this homeless guy wheeling toward me in a wheelchair, because that's what you do in a wheelchair, you wheel toward someone. And he had this busted up leg, and he asked me for directions. And so I looked at my phone, and where he was going was like a mile and a half away. So I turn and call my wife Beth, and I say, please turn on your Find a Friend apps. I think I'm supposed to do something here. So she says, okay, I hang up, and I offer the guy a ride. And he says, I don't think I can. My leg's busted up, and in fact, I haven't been in a car in 3 years. I was like, well, I'm game to try if you are. And so I go over and hoist this big guy out of his wheelchair, and we kind of hobble over to the passenger side of my car. And sure enough, his leg will not bend. It's not going to get in the car. And so I did what anyone would do in the situation. I rolled the window down, and we stuck his leg out it. And so there we are, driving through downtown LA with a man's leg out the car window. A lot of air, it was great. And so I asked him, I said, my name's Nick, what's your name? And he said, his name is Israel. And I said, I'm sorry, that is too on the nose for a church story. You are gonna need to do something about that name. And so I got to know his story a little bit, and he, as we're driving, he directs me to an address, and it's a tent over on Skid Row. Now, I don't know how many of you have been over to Skid Row lately after dark, and not to be flippant, but it is literally like a scene out of The Walking Dead. Like, it is just people roaming around in all sort of states of tragedy, and it's really sad. And so I pull the car in the middle of the street, and I'm realizing now that I have to get this guy back out of the car into the wheelchair, and I'm about to be very vulnerable. And so I start praying, God, please help me. Please help me. Gonna need your help, because don't want to die. I sing my prayers. I don't know if you do. I find it's really helpful. And so I get Israel back into his chair, and I put my hands on him, and I prayed for him and just prayed that he would feel seen and loved and that he was enough. And then I said, in Jesus' name, amen, as fast as I could, and got the hell out of there because I was terrified and was maybe in over my head. But these stories are just the first part of hospitality. It's about reaching out. And that's great, but they didn't turn into relationships. And so really, they're just kind of one-time acts of mercy. And those are great. We should be looking for those opportunities. But hospitality actually goes further. And so when God moves us toward people in hospitality, he can actually take strangers from neighbors and neighbors to family. And this can be our big idea today, the idea of becoming going from stranger to neighbor and neighbor to family. Now, I wasn't always interested in this type of hospitality, and nor was I particularly good at it. When I got married 17 years ago to my wife, Beth, joined her family, I could not understand why her parents saw fit to invite other people not related to us to Thanksgiving. I said, this is ridiculous. Your family is only together a few times a year. Holidays are for immediate family. I am not sharing my pumpkin pie with these people. What on earth are you doing? And I am not exaggerating. That is literally what a miserable person I was. I was the epitome of Scrooge. But that's just how I felt. And then something changed over time as you know, 17 years of seeing what it meant for our family to be family for people whose family was not nearby, or maybe they don't have a family at all. And now I see my in-laws' open door policy as the only one that matters. And I can't imagine a Thanksgiving without so many other people sharing their family traditions in the mix and being there with us. And I think that if we're honest, though, holidays are a really easy time to invite people to join us. I think it's the rest of life that's inconvenient. I don't know about you. I've got a long commute. I work long hours. Maybe you have kids and you have to get people to after-school events. Or maybe you've got a dog and you got to take them for a walk, or maybe you, or like me, you're a high gainer, you got to go to the gym and do sets of reps, right? Because that's what you do, right? Yeah. And so creating margin for hospitality isn't always easy, but sometimes it can change a life. So a few years ago, a friend of mine from Seattle called me, and he said there was a young family, husband, wife, and their toddler son, who was moving down to LA. They didn't know anyone, had no place to land. And so I said, great, send them to us. And so we moved our three kids into the girls' bedroom. Beth and I moved into our son's room, and then we put them up in our master bedroom so they could have a private bath and just have more space to sort of settle in. And then around the same time, we had noticed this dark SUV parked in front of the house next door to us. Now, the house next door to us is abandoned. We also live next to a freeway, so it's not uncommon to see people park in the car for a few days, live in there, and then move on. But this car had kind of been there longer, so I decided to investigate. And I met this young guy who was living in his car because he had lost his job in his apartment and was just trying to get back on his feet. So I said, all right, well, why don't you come to dinner? I've got new friends from Seattle, so none of us know each other. And so there we are in the backyard, the five of us Moseris. And we got this young dad who we learned was raised in the foster system. His wife, who's Native American, she was also adopted, their toddler son, and then this African-American guy who's living in his car. And the only reason I bring up everyone's different backgrounds is just we could not have been more different from one another. And there we were, all strangers, sitting around a table. And yeah, the small talk was a little awkward at times as we sort of got to know each other. But what was cool was those dinners continued on for over a year. And that family lived with us for 6 weeks until they found jobs and apartments and they moved out. The guy in his car, we would let him sleep above our garage on nights it was too hot or too cold to sleep in the car, and eventually he found his own place and his job. And what was cool was, as we knew them, the hospitality wasn't one way. It was them contributing to meals and them helping us clean up. And more than that, though, it was them sharing their lives and their stories with us, and we got to learn from them. And what's cool is we're all still friends to this day. In fact, I was texting with a few of them this morning. And they really, truly went from being strangers to neighbors to family. And when we share our table and our lives with people who don't look like us, who don't think like us, who don't vote like us, maybe who don't like us, we actually have the opportunity to gain empathy. And I think that's something that even if you're not a Jesus person, I think that you can get behind. And when the world is so divided, hospitality becomes a bridge. Now, there's a risk with hospitality, and I know that, right? Every time I put myself in these scenarios, I know that I could get burned, someone could take advantage of me, something bad could happen. And look, I want to strongly advocate for healthy boundaries, for being wise, for looking after yourself. I think all that stuff is super important. You don't want to just start jumping in and doing homeless Uber like I was doing. But don't let your avoidance of risk be your excuse. In fact, I actually think it's more dangerous not to get involved. Because when we don't, our hearts become calloused. And when that happens, we stop seeing people. And if we can't see them, there's no way that we can see the needs that they have. Now, some people think that I'm insane for exposing my kids to this kind of stuff. And I've got even more stories of the people in our neighborhoods that we're interacting with, homeless and otherwise. And I actually think it's a wonderful gift that we can give to our kids, because when we show our kids that we can handle the messy situations of other people's lives, when their lives get messy, we imprint on them that we can handle that too. And because we're in LA, I think it's important to say, please don't let your dreams distract you from the needs of other people. I think your dreams are great. I want you to all achieve all of them, but not at the expense of others. And so many of us, we come to church on a Sunday and we get told that we are part of the family of God. And then we spend the rest of the week just living as orphans, completely alone and isolated. And so I want the people of God to start to act like the family of God. And that means that we need to open our eyes, we need to open our doors, and we need to open our lives to the people around us. So how do we live this out? Well, we're going to go back to that letter we looked at earlier. We're going to be Romans 15, verse 7. It says, therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Well, how has Christ welcomed us? We're going to look at another letter from Paul, because again, I told you this guy likes his letters. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. And then we're going to jump to verse 19. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. I love this idea that God prepared these works in advance for us to do. We don't have to wonder if these opportunities are out there. We just have to look for them. And when we practice hospitality, we actually get to reflect the hospitality that Jesus offered to us when he died on the cross in our place, when he conquered a death that we deserved and invited us to become his family. And because God spared no expense to be with us, we don't have to hold back when we practice generosity. And it's not a new idea. Actually, God's been talking to his people about this from the beginning. Going back to the ancient Jewish scriptures, he was telling the Israelites to care for other people. Real quickly, we'll look at two verses. Deuteronomy 10, verse 19, love the sojourner, therefore, for you were sojourners in the land of Egypt. Sojourner is just another word for sort of a wanderer, transient. It basically describes everyone who lives in Los Angeles. And then we're going to jump to Leviticus 19, 33 and 34. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you are foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. You see, God knew that his people, then and now, knew what it felt like to be outsiders, to be outcasts, to be immigrants, to be refugees. And he told them, and he wants to tell us, that we need to love people differently. So one more story. Every Friday night in the Mosseri household is pizza night. There. Yep, we eat our pizzas and our Bibles. That's what he's doing there. He is not eating the pizza. He's going to eat the Bible. Okay, wait, this has to move on. Okay, so we have the Pierce family. They come over and have pizza with us. Now, the Pierces, they go to Radius here. They were a family that we met at our local elementary school, and they were looking for a new church, and so we invited them to Radius, and then we just decided to be intentional about our friendship because we were at the same school, and we didn't have a ton in common, but we just decided to do it. And so now we're going on 2 years of these dinners, and what's grown out of this is this really, really special friendship where we are able to celebrate with one another. At times, we have to mourn with one another. We look out after each other's kids, and we are family to one another in a city that can be super lonely. And just last week, we had other families in the mix because we don't want to keep this to ourselves. And this whole idea, this is actually why we have groups here at Radius. It's why we have Starting Point. It's why we have volunteering, so that you can go from stranger to neighbor to family right here in the church. And if you want to do this in your own home, in your own neighborhood, your own apartment building, all it starts with is with an invitation for someone to come over for a meal. And you just do it over and over and over again. And some of you may have objections or concerns or even excuses. Maybe you feel like, I don't have the space, I'm not good at it, I don't have the money. And actually, that's the beauty of hospitality, is that it shares what there is, no matter how much or how little. And people are happy to sit on your floor and eat. People are happy to eat soup. I don't know, hands up who likes soup? I don't know, I'm just kidding. Dumbest hands up. And people are also happy to clean up. There's this really cool woman named Rosaria Butterfield. She wrote this book. I cannot recommend it enough. It's called The Gospel Comes with a House Key. And she's really transformed a lot of my thinking on hospitality. But just one of the things that she does, I think it's so cool, is she always leaves unfolded clean laundry on her couch in her living room so that when people come over, they immediately have something they can do and contribute and help and jump in. Right? It's pretty good. And then the other thing I would say is don't do this alone. Use the buddy system. Find a friend. Find someone that you can partner with to invite your neighbors, to invite your coworkers, to start sharing meals together. And if it's not your place, whose home can you support? Who's got the space to do this that you can help contribute and help them to be able to host more people? And the other thing is, when we create these spaces to have these meals, I actually think what we're doing is potentially saving people from the real terrors of this world. I think that when you are gathered together, you are saving people from isolation, from depression, from addiction, from abuse. You might be saving a refugee or someone whose home burned down in one of the fires recently. The other thing you might be doing is being a comfort for someone who's suffering. So just a couple weeks ago, a buddy of mine, who's my first roommate in LA, he passed away after a 2-month battle with brain cancer. It could not have gone faster. And I had the great privilege of getting to go take a walk with him a couple weeks before he passed. And the cancer had started to really affect his balance and his vision, so I had to literally hold his hand as we're walking around his neighborhood. I've never been so aware of how uneven the streets of Altadena are, so if you work for the city of Altadena, please fix these streets. I only dropped him into the bushes twice. And as we walked, I was physically, literally supporting him, and yet he was right back there just encouraging me, and so we talked about our lives, we talked about our families, we talked about Jesus, and even though he's gone, I get to carry that forward, and we still get to have that relationship even though he's not with us. And I remember there's this really beautiful moment where I was holding his hand, and he just said, Nick, you know, the chemo, it just fogs my brain, it makes me feel like I'm not smart anymore. And I said, dude, don't blame the chemo, you were never smart. And look, hospitality is simple. he would like that joke a lot. But look, what if the world needs isn't another program or another politician or another preacher to fix it? Well, I actually believe what the world needs is for you all, and me included, to stop running, to stop hiding, to stop isolating, and move toward the people who are so desperate for an invitation to something better, and it just starts with a meal. And so here's the big idea today. Hospitality isn't entertaining, it's evangelism. I told you we'd get there. And when you practice hospitality, you're actually sharing the good news that there is hope for the hopeless, that there is community for the lonely, that there is safety from the storms of this world. And in that way, we get to point people to Jesus. And at a time when it feels like the church has lost so much credibility and the message of Jesus has been totally hijacked, we can begin to regain that by practicing hospitality. So, who's on your mind? Who's coming to lunch? Right now, if you are willing to, in the next, how many ever days left of November there are, if you will have a meal with someone new, just commit to inviting someone to a meal. Will you just raise your hand? Yeah. So all it takes, one meal. Now, I also wanted to start it today. So if you are willing to go have lunch with someone today, whether it's Pitfire, Chipotle, or go get some sandwiches in the park, will you stand? I want people to see. Who's willing to go have lunch with someone today? And so for you all, I want you guys to go meet over at the volunteer tent. And if you want to go have lunch, go see these people and figure out where they're going. My family, after second service, we're going to be at the In-N-Out Burger up on Lancashire. We're going to get food and go eat across the park. Start today. And for the rest of you, let's all stand. We're going to sing together. I'm going to go ahead and pray for us. God, I thank you for these people. I thank you for this church. I thank you that you have given us a practice that can share your love and that can save lives. It is so simple. And I pray that you would put in our hearts and minds this week the people that we need to... Oh, there we go. And just give us the boldness and strength to push in and take these risks. And I pray that you would bless our efforts. Thank you, God. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for listening. For more information, follow us on social media at Radius Church LA and visit us on the web at radius.la.